As was celebrated this morning by Mum and I getting up early and the kids sleeping until gone 9 o'clock. Wasn't quite the plan, but there are notice sheets available, which I think have been given out with the books. There's also Tidings, the church magazine, should be available at the back. Have you... Oh. Right. So what's left, Margaret, we'll put on the back. Can I just, from the notice sheet, just bring to your attention, the Lord increase our faith on the rear. Green Street are opening the church from the 1st to the 3rd of April. That's next Sunday, Monday and Tuesday. For a time of praise, prayer, fellowship. And just ask that we all can get involved in that. Right, this morning's service is going to be, the worship's going to be led by Bernie. And it's really good to welcome as well Reg and Christine down from Green Street to take the rest of the service.
Just a few other announcements. First of all, the tie is because the camera's here. I know there's some other thoughts. And Reg and Christine would like to be known as young Reg and Christine, not old Reg and Christine. Where are they? Great stuff. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will say, peace be with you." And as we gather here this morning, I really pray that God's peace would come upon you. Let's turn to mission praise number 149. Love divine or love's excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down.
See you. Let's turn to God in prayer.
Father God, as we gather here this morning, we just want to come and in your presence praise your name. We thank you, Father, that your love is great and almighty, that, Father, you love each one of us as we are now, and that, Father, although your desire is for us to grow closer and closer to you, that our distance doesn't prevent you from just putting your arms around us and loving us. And Father, we do just pray that we may be lost in wonder, love and praise as we come here to worship you today. Lord, let us just be caught up in great words of praise. Let us just be lifted up by your Spirit, that each one of us may just experience you in our lives today. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. We're going to turn to a few other songs. They're all in Mission Praise. That's the blue book in front of you. Starting off with number 65, Hallelujah for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Praise God. Just let your voices fly. Don't sort of hibernate. Yeah, it's summer nowadays. Just allow yourselves to be caught up in worshipping God. Turn to number 97 now. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. Turn to number 46. The reason we're glad is because we've got a God who loves us, and more than that, he wants us to love him too. Father, we love you, we worship and adore you. Let's just turn to the Lord in prayer once more. Let's pray. Father God, it's so good to come into your house and just be able to praise you. Father, we do thank you so much for loving us. But Father, we recognise the folk from this fellowship, the people all over this world who are not with you this morning. Perhaps, Father, they're ill and they're struggling. Perhaps they're in distant lands. Perhaps, Father, they just haven't heard of you and don't recognise you. But Father, we just pray that through our worship, it might not just be a time of worship here, but we may be able to take the joy, the happiness, all the good things that you give to us into this world and teach others about you. Father, we remember Lynn at this time in Sudan. Father, the desires in her heart to just return to Juba and be able to be with her church and her family there. We pray for Lynn, Father, that she may find strength, that she may find enjoyment, that she may find the gifts that you've given her in that place where she's doing the administrative duties. Father, we just ask that there she will find completeness in you. Think of others, Father, in this world, in South Africa, in Beirut, in places, Father, where there's unrest, where we have friends. And Lord, we just lift them up to you. Pray, Father God, that each day we may grow closer to a time when we'll find peace in this world. But we do recognise, Father, that peace only comes from you. That's where real peace comes from. That, Father, man-made peace just keeps things quiet for a while, but war soon erupts. But when we come to you, when we know your peace in our lives and in our hearts, then we know what real peace is, and it's an everlasting peace, one that lasts forever. And Father, we pray for this whole world, that everybody may find your peace in their lives. Think especially on this day when we think of our mothers. Father, we thank you for them. Thank you, Father, that for each one of us, you've given us a mother. Thank you, Father, that you have given us such wonderful mothers. Mothers that we can be proud of. Mothers that we want to thank you for. And Lord, we pray that today especially, that the children, that their friends, relations may just gather around them and give them support and let them know how much that we love them. And Father God, we just remember that no matter how much our mothers love us, that your love for us is greater. But we do pray that that will not hold us back from loving our mothers as you love us. Lord, we just give these things to you. We want to continue thanking you. We want to continue worshipping you. But Lord, we just pray above everything that today we may know your peace within our hearts. We ask this through Jesus. Amen. As it's Mother's Day, it's a good excuse, that is. You know, if it was Father's Day, it'd be as it's Father's Day. But as it's Mother's Day, is there a mother who's got a song she'd like to not sing personally? Come out here. Is there a song some mother would like us to sing? Crumbs. It's great, the response, isn't it? Can anybody play it?
Twinkling stars. Hands up, who knows it?
Right, all those mothers who know it, come out the front, please. Christine, can you give us a note to start on?
May the twinkling stars, the twinkling stars.
If you could have seen it, it's that group over there, they're the religious lot. There's another one that the kiddies love. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty. That's just to embarrass the mothers. What we should have done is had the mothers up here to do it. That would have been a lot better. We're going to continue worshipping God as we bring to Him our offering. Let's turn to number 151 in Mission Praise. 151. Let's just give thanks. Father God, we do just thank you so much for all that you've given us, all your goodness to us. Father, we just ask you now that as you take this offering, that you'll take us as well. That, Father, we lay before you now, not just money, not just coins, but we lay our lives and everything that is in our possession before you. We pray, Father, that you'll take them and use them to glorify your precious name. Amen. Suppose now we ought to introduce Christine to you. This is young Christine. Do you want to come join us? I've never had a chance to embarrass Christine. I remember them when they were a lot younger, but then they can say the same about me.
I remember you when you were a lot younger too. Is that all you're going to say?
Do you want me to really talk
no.
about it?
If you can just wait while I put this contraption on. I knew it. Right. When I was thinking about this today, I thought, well, Mothering Sunday goes back an awful long way to the time when people worked in service and were given a Sunday off to travel and visit their mums. Working in service means when you were a maid or a scullery maid. Maybe some mums here feel they work in service. I don't know. And I thought, what would the Lord have us learn from today? And I looked back to when I was a bit younger than I am now, and one of the things I remember doing with my mum is going shopping. Now, I would really like to talk to some people under 10, just round here quietly, so some of the grown-ups don't hear too much. Could some of you come here with the little ones? Anyone under 10? Yeah, come on then. Then just for a few minutes and then you can go back. That's it, come on then, Miriam. Anyone else? Anyone else? Right, any more? Jolly good. Here's another one. Splendid. Oh dear, I nearly tripped over that too. Now listen, very carefully. Have you ever been out shopping?
Yes.
With mum or dad or auntie, uncle, any grown up at all, and they say, I've just got a little shopping to do, and they make a list, and it's about this long. You know? Can you see some of the words written on that? Written it all out, and you go shopping with them, and you know the next shop to go to, and you go to the shop and you look round and they've got themselves lost. They've stopped to talk to somebody and you don't know where they are. Ever happened? And mums go yakety 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 yak 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 yak, and you're standing there waiting so patiently. Do you know about that? Well, now I'll tell you something. Not quite the same, but Jesus and his mum and dad got lost. And I want us just to think about that. You see, Jesus and his mum and dad travelled all the way from Nazareth to Jerusalem. And I got a map out yesterday and I measured it, and I think I could be corrected. I think it's 75 to 80 miles about. Now that is an awful long way to walk. And what happened was Jesus got left behind in the temple and his mum and dad went on. And I expect they were going yakety 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 yak all the time, don't you? But do you know what Jesus was doing? This is what he was doing. He was talking to the grown-ups and the teachers in the temple, and he was asking them questions. And when his mum and dad got back, they said, "Oh, where have you been? We've been so worried about you. Oh my goodness, you know." Do they ever say that? Oh, they don't. Oh, I think I better have a word with them, don't you? Well, Jesus' mummy and daddy were very worried. But this is the thing I'd like you to remember when you go home today, not only with your mums, but with mummy, daddy, anybody, grown-ups in the church, in the family of the church. Jesus was there in the temple talking about God, his Father. He asked questions. You do the same. Ask questions and talk about Jesus. Talk about Jesus at home. Talk about Jesus when you're here. Look, there are all these grown-ups. We're all a family. Talk about Jesus. You have to go back to your mummies now. And as they were talking about Jesus, of course, the adults, the grown-ups, the teachers in the temple were listening. They were amazed, Scripture tells us. They were amazed at Jesus. And I was reminded very much of the time when I too was absolutely amazed by something one of our children said. Now, I am sometimes very amazed, not pleasurably amazed by some of the things they say, but this was a very salutary thing. It had happened that Reg's mum had died. That day, one of the children prayed this: "Thank you, Jesus, for giving Nanny a brand new body that's just right for heaven." And I realized that I was learning something very, very precious from one of my children. And although it is Mother's Day, what I feel the Lord is saying to each of us is talk about Jesus. Talk about God, ask questions, make time to listen, make time for each other. I read in my newspaper yesterday that apparently £23 million 2 years ago was spent on flowers for Mother's Day. £23 million in this country. £22 million on top of that was spent on cards. I love receiving flowers and I love receiving cards. But it is no substitute for making time to talk about Jesus and to listen. I know it's difficult. I don't know if my family are unusual, but they always ask questions at the most impossible time. Either when the phone's ringing, the potatoes are boiling, somebody's at the door, and the next person needs to be out in 5 minutes' time and the meal's not ready. Or when I'm feeling absolutely shattered, about 11:30 at night, they come out with some profound question. Jesus turned and he condemned the disciples for not giving time to children. Let us not face that same condemnation, whether we're mothers, dads, uncles, aunts, or even whether it's in the larger family of the church. The most precious thing we can give to mothers, anybody within our family today, is time to listen and time to talk about the things of God. And I pray that God will bless each of you as you do that.
This could be difficult too.
Just
while Christine's getting undone. I was a bit worried when Roger got up to help her, because if you're in a TV studio, he would have threaded that down the back of your neck. thank you, Christine, for just sharing those few thoughts. Yeah, when we think about Mother's Day, it's one of the aspects I'd never thought of is that the fact that, you know, we really need to spend time with our children. We always think about the mothers. We always think about them, and your mothers are all sitting back and waiting for breakfast, and Christine would still be waiting if it was in our house. But the fact that as a family, we ought to talk about Jesus. Yeah, thank you very much, Christine, just for sharing those few simple things with us. I'm going to turn once more to Mission Praise. To number 102. And you're going to sing very loud, aren't you? I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. Just to give you a bit of exercise, for one of the great things about having Reg and Christine here is that you get twice as much for your money's worth. Christine's just said, "Are we getting paid?" I don't know, Christine, you might do. Yeah, I was just about to say, it's one of your future pupils there, Reg. But Reggie's another one that I'd love to embarrass.
You do that frequently, Ben. But, carry on.
I can remember, a few years ago, when I first started going to church, and I was roughly, 16, 17 then? I was getting quite old to be going to church. Thank you. And I went along to Green Street simply because my brother went there. I woke him up one morning, said, "Can I go to church with you, Ken?" He says, "Yeah, all right." So I went along. The first sort of person I met really was Reg, because it's into his Sunday school class I went. And, Reg, even if I do say so myself, I think you've done a really good job.
It is good to be with you. Can I just share with you something quite important as an emphasis on age? Saturday week, we went to change cars, and there was this very smooth salesman there, you see, and my son and wife had decided which car we were going to buy, so that was all right. It took the decision away from me, and we went into the office and sat down and started to fill in the forms, and the salesman said, "Now, sir, how old are you?" So I said, "I'm 49. "Oh, that is a pity," he said. "That is a pity." So I wasn't quite sure what he was getting at. So I said, "Why is it a pity that I'm 49? So he said, "Sir, if you were 50, I could do you a very good deal on insurance, but as you're only 49, you've got to carry on paying the full rate." So there are compensations for getting old. It's good to be with you, and it's a great joy to be with my wife this morning and taking part in the service here. I want us to spend a little bit of time this morning thinking about the nature of God. One of my favourite hymns is one that I'm sure many of you know. It is this: Almighty, invisible, the God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. And there is a sense in which, because these statements about God are true, we can only have a very limited understanding of this wonderful being that we call God. He is indeed almighty. That means he is more powerful than anything else or anyone else in the universe. He is invisible to us. But the reason that he is invisible to us is because we could not look at him and survive. Such is his greatness, such is the power of his being, that were we able to see him, we would perish in the experience. Because all that God is, we are not. He is infinite, we are finite. He is everlasting, we have a beginning and an end. And God too is surrounded by light that is inaccessible to us and hid from our eyes. Indeed, our natural view of God is so limited and so restricted that when I was young, 30 years ago, some of the current thinking even went so far as to say that God was in fact dead. And I can remember the controversy of the book God is Dead by the late Bishop of Woolwich, Dr. Robinson, who made this statement at the beginning of the 1960s and said, God is dead. We don't need God anymore. Mankind has grown up. But the amazing thing is that it was just as Bishop Robinson was making these statements that God was actually taking a new initiative with his creature man. And what God was doing at that time was changing our view of him. So that God indeed was dead. The God that was dead was the feeble God of man's imagination. The God that no longer existed was the God that man had created in man's image. But the God that does exist, the God that is almighty, invisible, the only wise God, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes, that God was very much alive and continues to be very much alive even down until today. You see, the God of the Bible, the God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, this God is alive. And when man is tempted to say that he is not alive, it is because man's view of God is wrong. God's view, however, of man is always correct. And it seems to me that the picture that we have is, here is us, mankind, limited, finite, failing, peering out through the bars of a prison which we call time. And through the little window in the cell of our prison, we have a vague idea of what God is like. But the picture we get of God is as limited as the picture through a cell window, and the comparison of the picture through a cell window with the wonderful world that is actually outside. And that picture for me is very meaningful when I come to consider something of the nature of God. It was, of course, Moses who, faced with this phenomenon in the desert of a bush that seemed to be burning yet did not burn, realized that he was actually in the presence of God. And God said to Moses, take off your shoes, because the place where you are standing is holy. And Moses said, but who are you? Who are you that I can go and say things in your name? And God's reply was very simple and very precise. God said to Moses, when you go, you say, I am. That's my name. My name is I am that I am. And in a sense, Moses, that's all you need to know about me. Because I exist, everything else has explanation. Because I am, everything else has meaning and purpose. And that statement, that name that God gave to Moses, in fact, goes on to give us a greater understanding of what God is really like. I want to suggest to you that God is, in fact, omnipotent. That means he is all-powerful. He's all-powerful in creation. He's all-powerful as the sustainer of all things. If you took God out of the equation of the universe would collapse. But because God is there, the universe continues. But God is also there as provider, and he's also there as king. And then again, God is omnipresent. That means he fills all things. He is in all things, and all things exist because of his power. And God is omniscient. That means he is all-knowing. There is nothing hid from him. Nothing that happens, nothing that takes place, does so without God's knowledge. Indeed, it was Jesus who said that when that sparrow falls off the fence, God knows about that. And when your hairs come out in the comb, God knows, because he has numbered all the hairs of your head. And supremely, I think, we see most of God's character when we consider his fatherhood. We can know him as Father through Jesus the Son and by the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's significant, is it not, that Jesus taught us to pray to the Father. The Jews regarded God as the Father of Israel. Jewish fathers were noted for the exercise of their authority and their intense concern for children. The fatherhood of God is seen not as a sentimental idea, but as a very powerful thing in which we understand that God is to be revered and God is to be obeyed. But that same God cares passionately for us, his children. And I would refer you to the parable of the prodigal son, where we see a loving father in relationship with a wayward child. I had two parents, but I must confess to you that my relationship with them was not particularly good. The reasons for that we needn't go into in great depth, except to say that for the first 7 years of my life, my father wasn't at home. He was on the continent of Europe, involved with the British Army, chasing the Nazis back into Germany. And that created a problem for me. It created a problem for me when I was told that God was my father. And because of a relatively poor relationship with my own dad, I had problems in relating to God as father. And I remember one day when I was going to a session of worship led by Graham Kendrick at Tunbridge Baptist Church. And I sat in the back of that church while the worship was going on around me. And we came to that lovely song, "Thank you, O my Father, for giving us your Son." And I suddenly realized that as I could relate to Jesus, and Jesus related to God as Father, so I could relate to Father as his child and as his son. And it's only when we have experiences of that sort that it really comes into focus and we can really understand a little more of the nature of this wonderful God who is our Father. You would be absolutely justified in saying to me, "Reg, that's marvellous, thank you very much, but it's Mother's Day, not Father's Day." And of course that is very true. It is Mother's Day. But in just the same way as part of God's character is revealed to us in the picture of a father, so I believe the Bible has something to say to us about the characteristics that are possessed by mothers in relation to their children. I'd like to conclude with just one or two pointers that I have found helpful. Firstly, let me say this, that some sections of the church have spoken of the church as Mother Church. Now, I can understand what they're saying. Yes, indeed, the church is the place of nurture and of growth. It is the place where many come to birth, new birth, in Jesus Christ. But this idea, I think, has an inherent danger. And the inherent danger is that the Bible teaches that the church is primarily the bride of Christ. The church will be presented by Jesus to the Father as his bride. And that brings us in conflict, surely, with the teaching of the church as mother. But the Bible also teaches that mothers have a place of honour. Indeed, it is a place of honour that is equal to the Father. The instructions given to children throughout the Old Testament and indeed in the New are along these lines. Children, honour your fathers and your mothers. There is to be an equality of honour for mothers as for fathers. Thirdly, mothers are to be the source of teaching. Do not forget the teaching of your mother. Don't forget the things that your mother taught you. And that, of course, applies to godly mothers. And the testimony of many of the great saints of old has been that it was at their mother's knee that they first came to hear about God and his love for us through Jesus Christ. No wonder then the Bible tells us not to forget the teaching of our mothers. But finally, I want to suggest to you that this great omnipresent, omniscient God, this great sustainer of all things, also possesses within himself, if only there was a neutral adjective, this great created God possesses with himself qualities which we can see typified in our mothers and in our relation to them. Isaiah 49 says this: Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child that she has borne? Though she may forget, I will have compassion upon you. I will not forget you. Now those words are spoken by God himself. And what he's saying is that in the normal course of events, the relationship between mother and child, the bond between mother and child, is a very, very strong one. And in exceptional circumstances, only that bond can be broken. But even if in a natural mother, the bond between mother and child is broken, God says, I will never, ever forsake you. I will never let you go. The bond between you and me is forged, and it is so strong that nothing will ever, ever break it. He says, See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hand. The ancient priests carried on their hands the names of all the tribes of Israel, so that they were constantly there. And as they went about their duties, whenever they held up their hands, there on their hands were the names of the tribes for which they were responsible. And God says, Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has borne? Though she may forget, I will have compassion upon you. I will not forget you. See, I have engraved on my hands your names. And then in Isaiah 66 we read these words. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. Now that word comfort is a lovely word. It suggests a nestling down into something that is warm, protective, something that is surrounding, something that is safe, something that is well known. And looking around, there are some of the little ones that are nestling into mum's arms at this moment. Some of them aren't, but some of them are. Nestling into their mother's arms because their mother's arms are the place of comfort. It's the same picture, surely, as of a hen gathering her chicks under her wings and getting them into that place of security, that place of comfort, that place where the dangers all around are put on the outside because mother places herself there. The hen places herself over the chicks to protect them and give them comfort. And on this Mother's Day, that, I believe, is what God wants to say to us. He says to us this morning, I want to gather you under my wings to give you protection. I want to gather you in my arms to give you comfort and security. I want to bring you to the place in your experience where you know the comfort that I can give you. Just as a child nestles into its mother's arms, or as a chick is gathered under the wings of a hen. And it may be that many of us just need to be reassured that this great Creator God, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, has the capacity to comfort us and give us security against the knocks and hardships of life, as a mother comforts her child and as a hen gathers her chicks. Will you join me now in singing one of the great hymns of the church, which is on the similar theme and begins with the words, A Sovereign Protector I Have. It is number 570 in the Baptist hymn book.
Please sit down. Let's just consider what's been said to us as we turn to God, with just for a short prayer, so we can recall what's been said and just fix these firmly in our minds. Father God, we just thank you so much for Reg and Christine. Thank you for allowing them and giving them words to speak to us. And Father, we think of that picture of the mother, picture of a place where children find rest and comfort, a place where they feel safe, a place where they find instruction. Father, we thank you for our mothers. Thank you, Father, that even though sometimes we don't appreciate it, all their fussing is really their care for us. The times when they seem annoyed, they're annoyed because
They want to protect us and keep us from harm. The times when we seem in trouble, the times when they're trying to teach us how we ought to live. And Father, we just thank you so much that you've put so much of your character into them. And Lord, as we consider our mothers, as we thank them for what they've been to us, we just ask, Father, that our thoughts may also turn to you and to the fact that you love us as well. Father, we give you thanks for our mums, and we pray that you will indeed just bless them. We pray, Father, that you'll fill their lives with a great joy and a great love. And Lord, enable us to love them too. We ask this through Jesus Christ. Amen.
This morning we've got the privilege of having four children to be put on the cradle roll. For those that don't know what the cradle roll is, it's a way that we can keep in touch with new young children that come within the area, and that we can invite them when on their third birthday to come along to Sunday school. So they have a cradle roll certificate, which is like this, which just has their name, their date of birth, the church here, and the date that they were actually enrolled. And then, as I say, when they're three, they're invited to come along. So I'd like to ask Katie Louise Batten and her mum to come out to receive their certificate. Zoe Ellen Turner. I think Zoe's actually gone to sleep now. Shh. Tiptoe down the aisle. They look beautiful when they're asleep, don't they? Timothy James Barker. Timothy, Tim, you're going to come out. Looks like we'll soon be having this one in Sunday school. Nice live wire, eh? And Mark, it's the flowers. Mark Anthony Underwood. Hello. He normally cries this one when he sees me, so I won't look at him. Right, now as it's our normal tradition for Mother's Day, we have flowers for the mums. What I'd like to do is to ask the children of the Sunday school to come forward to collect some flowers. If your mother is here, then you take them to your mum now, give them a nice big smackaroo kiss and their flowers. If your mum is not here though, just hold on to them, you can take them home. So the children of the Sunday school, I think you all know who you are. Children. here that have got their mums here, would they like to come out and receive some flowers? It doesn't matter if you're a visitor, whoever you are. I'm going to give one to Mama, because I'm an older child.
Christine's just said you're all waiting for me. I can almost guarantee you, but if somebody says to Reg, what was it like down the mission, he can honestly say, complete chaos. It's the way we like to be. We're now going to turn to 281 in Mission Praise. 281. I hope that the words that you're about to sing will be true in your hearts. You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. Let's stand and sing. Father, we thank you so much for all the good things that you give to us, for the opportunity to just come and worship someone who is so glorious and so mighty. And Father, we do indeed just ask that as we leave this place, that Father, we won't just take flowers with us, but we'll take your joy, your love, and your spirit in our hearts, that we may share that with those that we meet. Lord, we pray that throughout all our days, we may be able to glorify and praise your precious name. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.